sunshine was the perfect stage for the greatest game of the year. The Duke of Edinburgh, newly home from his world tour, greeted the finalists Luton Town and Nottingham Forest. There was an atmosphere of excitement such as only the Cup final produces. 100,000 people saw Captain Sid Owen and Jack Birkett exchange banners under the eye of Her Majesty. Luton kicked off playing from right to left, wearing light shirts. From the start, Forest seemed much more at home in the great stadium, taking the ball into the Luton goal area. Quigley got in a shot which Ron Bainham was lucky to clear at the second attempt. At the other end, a Luton attack was fouled by left half Jack Birkett. In goal, Chick Thompson showed signs of Wembley nerves, but Birkett cleared. Forest centre forward Tommy Wilson cleverly put the ball out to his wing. Stuart Imlach passed it right, and it was in the net. Notts were a goal up in 10 minutes. What a wonderful start. An early goal is a great tonic in any match, nowhere more than in the Cup final. Notts attacked again. Before Bainham knew it, Wilson headed the second goal. No wonder Forest were jubilant. In 14 minutes, there were two goals up, and they didn't intend to rest on their oars. Dwight was tackled by right-back McNally. To Nottingham's dismay, he was put on a stretcher. So, after little more than half an hour, Forest were reduced to 10 men. Wembley Cup final history was indeed repeating itself. Now, if ever, Luton had a chance to draw level. They put on the pressure, and Forest were lucky to escape at the expense of a corner. This was the most anxious moment Billy Walker's men had had so far, but they survived till half-time. Forest supporters were in high fettle when play was resumed and Forest kicked off. They led 2-0, but it was noticed that Roy Dwight was still off the field. He was out of the match with a broken shin bone. But Nottingham weren't content with defence. Straight away they attacked, and Luton goalkeeper Ron Bainham had to clear. It was only a brief respite. Forest, inside left Billy Gray, began another attack. Centre-forward Tom Wilson headed to Imlach. It brought no reward, but it did show that the depleted Forest were as full of fight as ever. The question was, could they keep up the strain? Luton, outside left, Tony Gregory made ground and put the ball dangerously into the middle. A Luton header was intercepted, fortunately for Forest. Is the leadership okay, Monty? Notts goalkeeper Chick Thompson saw danger coming on the Luton left. Centre-half McKinley conceded a corner. Left-back Ken Hawes put the ball across the goal, and left-half Dave Pacey beat Thompson with a great shot. How the Hatters cheered. Only one goal behind now. It put new heart into Luton. Thompson saved. Bingham robbed McDonald, only for Pacey to shoot wide. Again, Bingham centred. Great chance for Luton here, but again, Chick Thompson got the ball away. The whistle went for time. Nottingham Forest had won the cup. Skipper Jack Birkett led his team of 10 men for the Royal Box. It's 61 years since Forest won the cup before. What a triumph for him and his brilliant team, but what a tragedy that Roy Dwight wasn't there to receive his medal. To win the cup is a great feat at any time. To win with 10 men is an epic achievement.
Back with the cup. It was every footballer's dream come true for Nottingham Forest. Jack Birkett had the trophy, and there too was Roy Dwight, whom not even a broken shin bone was going to deprive of the thrill of coming home with a team. It was cheers all the way from the Midland Station, on a tour of the city to Market Square, 30,000 cup-happy fans lining the roof. They said there were 70,000 in the square and nobody asked for a recount. Birkett still bore the trophy as, with Dwight and the other teammates, he made his way to the balcony of the council house. Nottingham had never known such an evening. The most treasured, hardest to win cup in all sport was there for all to see. Most worthily won by a brilliant team, Nottingham Forest.
What was the plans leading up to the cup final that week? Did you go down to London the night before? And
no, we went down a few days before an actual fight.
We went on a Monday.
Yes, yes, we went down a few days before to Wimbledon, wasn't it?
We trained
on their ground.
No, the Hendon. We went to Hendon. We stayed at Hendon.
That's right. Yes.
But
pretty relaxing, really, wasn't it? There was very little training. One of the laughs,
Bob, was when they tried to get us to meet outside the ground, away from the ground, to try and dodge the journalists and that.
Oh, yes. Yes,
that was a bit of a laugh, really, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's right. There were all sorts of things. I think we got it right in as much that there was virtually no training as such. It was very, very light because at the end of the season you don't want a lot of training anyway. And everything was on very low key, and it was the happy atmosphere type of thing. Well, look, let's go and enjoy it on Saturday, this type of thing. And yes, it worked quite well. We had quite a good squad in actual fact in those days. You know, in the fight, the 59 side, we all got on pretty well together. To say, I mean, when you're away together for a week, usually there's one or two little bits and pieces, you know, bitchiness and that sort of thing, which must creep in. But no, it was a pretty good preparation for it.
You had plenty of experienced players in the squad as well, didn't you? So
yes.
People who'd been through the mill and knew what life was all about at that point.
Yes, we had one or two older players, like Billy, you know, and there were one or two others. Joe McDonald was another one who'd been up, played for Sunderland and had quite a bit of experience. And one or two of us had quite a few matches under our belt, so it wasn't an inexperienced young side. The side was settled. It was the side that had played virtually in all the cup matches.
Yeah, every match,
I don't
yeah.
think ever, there was no other player played in any of the rounds, so that was the team. So we knew each other pretty well, and we got on pretty well together, and I think it gave us quite a good start. They, I think, were particularly nervous, thinking back on the day. Luton Town, who seemed to be sort of twitching a little bit while the presentation was being made before the game. Some of our chaps were waving up to the wives, etc., in the stand, and I thought, yes, we've got the right frame of mind to take this game on today. And indeed, it turned out that way.
It worked out well. What was it like going down Wembley Way in the Forest coach?
Prior to the match, that was quite exciting. You know, you think you recognise everybody, but you don't recognise anybody, and your mind's not really on the crowd anyway. You're starting to get hyped up a little bit by that time. But it was absolutely marvellous atmosphere.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's a one-in-a-lifetime thing.
You're trying to relax, but you can't.
It's very difficult.
You know, once you get into the swim of the crowds and the traffic and all the tradition of Global Cup finals, you become part of it.
Just get wrapped up in it. The match itself, apart from Roy Dwight, unfortunate incident, what was your recollections of that at the time? You must have thought, well, the Wembley jinx has struck again, and are we going to be... unlucky here, but
no, I didn't feel as though we were going to lose the tie in actual fact. The game
played well
because they were pumping high balls because we were a man short. They were pumping high balls into the middle, and I just happened to be on song that day. I don't know why, but I was. And I thought, well, this is tailor made because obviously we were having to do less amount of running. Had they approached us coming through midfield and then onto us, then we'd have to have done that much more work. We would have tired that much quicker, and maybe we might have lost the advantage. But they seemed content to pump the ball into our area, which was tailor-made for our defenders. So I thought they approached it wrong when we were down to 10 men. If they'd sort of a slow build-up and come at us, made us run about a bit, that last quarter an hour or 20 minutes, and then we might have done something out of exhaustion that we wouldn't normally have done.
But we were very fortunate, you know. We had Stuart Imlach, and there was one thing Stuart can do, it's run. And he can
France,
run.
France cover the 1959, huh?
Well, Stuart can not wasn't only fast, but I mean he was the sort of person who could probably run all day. You know, he had that sort of makeup, hadn't he, Bob?
Yes.
A whippet type, you know.
Yes.
He was slight. He was like whippet type, you see. And to me, that was the one time where I thought Stuart used what he was best at. You know, going all over the park.
His work rate getting, was high, wasn't it?
Getting involved, getting the ball, running with it, holding it. You know, I believe he got man of the match, didn't he?
Yes, I think. Yeah. Yes, he did.
Got the man of the match. And being honest, you know, if he had been an ordinary sort of run-of-the-mill player, you know, like Bob and I, like, you know, sort of style.
Thanks, Bill. I knew you'd get your
own quick. I think we might have been struggling a bit more. But like I say, Stuart could run all day. And that afternoon, he never stopped, and he made it, really, that you didn't miss the extra man quite so much as you might have done.
What were the celebrations like afterwards then? Did they start immediately after the match, or did you wait till you got back to Nottingham?
Yes, no, we stopped down in London and we went to the we were at the Savoy. We stayed overnight and we had the dinner there where, well, everybody was there. And that was a great night in itself. And then we went down to Brighton on the Sunday lunchtime and then came back Sunday night, was it?
I don't think we should say anything about that, do you?
Why? Did you have an extra drink or something?
Just for a change.
Yes.
I was about 30, I was trying to get into about 10 by 12 room for to watch a 12-inch television to see the match, I think.
I wondered what you were going to say there, Billy.
It's right, you know, we were all crowding into the small 12-inch television there, and everybody's trying to get in, and everybody's trying to watch it.
That was down in Brighton, yeah, wasn't it?
That was down in Brighton, yeah. And there was gales, and raining gales blowing, wasn't it? Mm.
What was the homecoming like then, back in Nottingham? That must have been a bit special, wasn't it?
Oh, that was fantastic, yeah, that was... Probably even superseded the excitement, certainly before the match and during the match. One concentrates on the game and you're not thinking about anything else. But that was probably the highlight, were the number of people that turned out. It was absolutely super. You know, we toured right round Nottingham and finished back up at the council house. I walked down the centre of the to the council house itself, and the place was just a mass of red and white. You know, it was something that I'll never forget it.
Well, I think the turnout even surprised the police, because prior to going away, before the cup final, it didn't seem as though the public at large were interested in the fact we had reached the cup final. But when we came back, you know, I think the entire town turned out.
I can remember seeing photographs of people hanging around lampposts and things like that.
Yes, there were indeed. Well, you see it virtually every year in every city now, but, you know, when once that actually happens to you, then it's something else. Because Nottingham people generally, and particularly the Forest supporters, they were always recognised to be rather on the conservative side, where it really took a lot to get them out, and certainly, you know, out into the streets like that. So we were surprised with the number of people that actually turned up.
I believe they were crowded on the rail platform itself, weren't they?
Well, the station, the police allowed only a certain number of people down onto the platform, obviously for safety reasons with the trains and whatnot. And then I thought, well, there's a good crowd here, and it was only 1% probably of the number of people that actually turned out that day when we come back. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely
fantastic.
Wonderful.
It was very fantastic.
Then we had a do at night as well, didn't we?
Oh, yeah.
We had one of the Sherwood rooms or something like that, wasn't it? We had a bit of a party again, so it was party all the time, you know. In fact, you had to sit down and have a real breather, because everything was happening. And everybody obviously wanted to talk to you and all the rest of it. But a wonderful experience it was.
Lovely. That's smashing on the football. Can we just tie up by sort of asking you, we know what Billy's doing here, but we all should explain really, Bill, what your boiler suit's all about. You're a groundsman at the City Ground these days. Enjoying your work?
Yes, everything's going very well for me so far. Brian's been very good to me, helps me, gives me the help that's required, and everything's gone very well. Haven't got no problems at all.
It's nice to be involved back at the football club.
Oh, but it's always pretty nice to be involved in football, isn't it? Especially when it's been your life, like it has with me, you know.
Bob, can I just ask you what you're doing with yourself these days?
Yeah, not a lot. You wouldn't think he was 65, would you? Yeah, you're wearing well, you know, Bill. You know, you're not eating that grass, are you? So I work for the government, prison officer at Loudoun Grange. It's a youth custody centre. And I've been there for nearly 14 years now. In fact, another 10 years and I can retire. Yeah. Awesome.